probably an emerging international American icon, one of the few people who do hunt on horseback with eagles. She's really set the standard here in America and beyond our borders. She earned a doctorate degree from St. Andrews in Scotland and has been a wonderful guest thus far. She is truly an American icon. At this point, Dr. McGough.
Jim Fowler. I didn't have the privilege to meet him, but everybody in my orbit has been influenced by him. Everyone in this tent has been influenced by him. What a titan. None of us would be where we are in wildlife conservation and education without Jim Fowler. So yes, I had a really weird dream to be a Mongolian eagle hunter. So when I was a kid, I was really socially awkward and super anxious, and I was very lucky to discover falconry. So I had a red-tailed hawk, and when I'd get home from school, I'd come off the school bus, get my red tail, and we would go out into the woods. And we would have a shared goal to try to catch a rabbit. So I really liked the idea of getting dinner the super hard way. Like, let's catch a hawk, train it for a couple months, take it out in the woods and see if you can find a rabbit together. But it made me a much better person. And one day when I was in the library in high school, I came across this book about travels in Central Asia. And there was this black and white photo of a Kazakh man in Mongolia on horseback. So he's got all these fox furs on him, a fox fur hat. He's riding a horse. And on his right arm is a golden eagle, which will be here shortly. Now, golden eagle is the largest eagle in North America. It's an incredible hunter. It's found circumpolar, so across Europe and Asia. They weigh about 10, 11 pounds, which might not sound like a lot, but when you're flying with hollow bones, that is a lot. Holding it on your arm, that's a lot. I saw this photo and I thought, wait, this exists? This is a thing? And I just knew I had to go there and had to do it. But the problem was, all right, I didn't know how to fund it. I didn't know how to find these people, how to get there. So we had a guy come to my, I promise there's an eagle in there. So I might have to pull John out. Had a guy come to my school and talk about Fulbright scholarships. A Fulbright scholarship is funding for you to live in another country for a year and do an independent research project. Now, top tip to anybody that wants a scholarship. Perfect. Thank you, John. Choose a place nobody else wants to go. Yes, remember the slice? There were only a few applications to go live in Mongolia, and I was chosen. So I got the funding, and I went out there, and I showed up and met some nomadic families. Now, these are people that live entirely with animals. So they live in yurts. All their livelihood is based on animals. Horses, camels, goats, sheep, cows, and of course, golden eagles. So what they use golden eagles for is to obtain fox fur to keep them warm. It's a super harsh, cold environment. Now these eagles are living wild in Mongolia and hunting foxes all the time. It's just what they do naturally. So what the Mongolians have figured out is if I can convince this bird to be my hunting partner, then maybe I can take the fox fur and she can take the meat and we can both benefit. So that's what I wanted to do. And when I started, so I met this family and they agreed to be my mentors and teach me how to do this. I was terrible. It's terrible. I fell off my horse. I could barely communicate. I got frostbite because I was brought terrible clothing. I mean, I'm very lucky they put up with me because I'm sure there was a lot of laughing that went on behind my back. But I persevered, and the way that they teach their children there is not so much through direct communication, but through visually, through learning by doing. So they put me on a horse, and when I fell off, they put me back on again. And I just had to watch them and try to figure it out on my own, which totally was out of my comfort zone, very difficult. But there's a couple milestones I really remember well. One is the first time I told a joke in Kazakh, their language, and people laughed. Like, oh my God, I can't communicate. And it was funny. And another time was when we were flying the eagles, and I was the first one to the fox after the eagle had caught the fox. Because for so long, I was always in the back. There'd be three eagle hunters that would rush over to the fox. And then here's Lauren, like, slowly coming down the mountain. But I figured it out. And it ended up being an incredible experience. One of the most memorable things was when my first eagle caught its first fox. It's a very big moment in the life of a Kazakh in Mongolia. Oh, I wish I had taken my daughter hunting. So there was some cross-cultural learning going on there, and I went there because of the eagles, but the eagles ended up being the connection to help me understand and connect with the people. So that inspired me to be an anthropologist, which is the study of cultures, rather than a biologist. But what's fascinating over there is there's many layers of learning. So there's human to human. There's human to eagle, of course, where you learn to communicate with the eagle. Because whether you're a prince or a pauper, the eagle treats you the same. And you can only use positive reinforcement. So you somehow, through your own ingenuity, have to figure out how to convince this animal that you're worthy of being its partner. It doesn't always work. And then, of course, there's even eagle to eagle. In the very beginning, I flew my young eagle with my mentor's experienced eagle. And they learned from each other. And what's been particularly wonderful about this visit is I see the exact same layers of learning happening here at Green Chimneys. I see students learning from their teachers, learning from the animals, and even these animals learning from each other, because so many of them have had difficult starts in life and backgrounds. So you do not have to go halfway across the world and live with a nomadic tribe to see this kind of human-animal magic. You just have to come to Green Chimneys. So yeah. We're gonna see if we can't take the hood off so you can see this beautiful golden eagle's eyes. So you might wonder how you hunt foxes in Mongolia. All right. You gotta perch yourself on top of the highest mountain in the area because the eagle needs a height advantage. So as long as the eagle can be above the fox, it's got a chance at catching it. So you're sitting on top of the mountain and then you take the hood off. And eagle eyesight is 7 to 8 times better than ours. It's incredible. So you're sitting up there and you've got this whole vista of Mongolia out before you. And you're waiting to see if a fox moves. Now the problem is you can't rely on your own eyesight because it's not good enough. Not to see this little red-colored dot scooting along the distance. You have to learn to read the very subtle bits of the eagle's movements and behavior to see if it sees something. So maybe she starts like bobbing her head or like leaning way out there. You think, okay, maybe there's a fox there. And then as soon as she goes, you might see her pump out. Power out. You're still not sure where the fox is, but you see her flying up and up. And then all of a sudden she folds up like a huge 12-pound feathered missile and comes all the way down to the ground. And about 10-20% of the time she catches the fox, and the other part of the time the fox does a maneuver, makes the eagle look silly, and laughs as it goes back into the mountains. All right, thank you very much.
Grateful again from Green Chimneys for the terrific work she has done.
Lauren, we thank you for the very kind words. We are very pleased you're a new friend to Green Chimneys. And most importantly, you reflect the spirit of the Falconry. So we thank you, and we hope another 27 years. What do you folks think, another 27 years? On behalf of the Green Chimneys family, Lauren, thank you. And we really appreciate your time, your effort, your energy, and of course, your spirit. So thank you.
Beautiful.
Lauren.
Beautiful.